thank each of you for being with us today. We appreciate you taking time to hear conservative ideas, to talk about the issues that are important to our organization and hopefully to you. You know, to some extent, it is unfortunate that we have to have this center. We have to have these programs. If you had the equivalent liberal point of view, you would get it in your high school classrooms. You would absolutely, for sure, get it in your college classrooms. You wouldn't have to make a special effort to hear conservative ideas from a conservative point of view. There may be a few of you that are lucky enough to have that point of view in your high school, but I can tell you when you get to the college level, it's going to be very few and far between campuses in the country that gives conservative ideas a fair shake. I listened to all your introductions last night, enjoyed hearing the different reasons that you were here. I knew it would only be a matter of time before a student said that he or she was here to make America great again. But really, you want to make America great for you. You want to live in freedom. You want to make more choices. And I'm going to touch on that today. I'm going to give you at least a couple examples that I think will be readily understood by your classmates in terms of an argument for conservative ideas or for free market ideas. So I'm going to get to that. Most of this part of my time is actually your time presenting what you think conservative movement is, conservative ideas. Last night, Babe Buchanan made it quite clear that she gave you techniques to hone your leadership skills, but she definitely stressed that the important thing is for you to think about what issues are most important to you. So you've already had a half-hour session where you've talked about those issues that are important to you, that you believe are part of the core conservative values. We're going to talk about a lot of important values, and among those values are those that we think you'll want to hone your arguments on. You'll choose the ones that resonate most with you. And so that's the principal purpose of this morning's presentation, if you will. But before I get into it, I want to mention one other item about the conference ahead of you, and then give you some examples of why talking about conservative principles rather than conservative personalities, even though you're here to, in some respect, study one personality, one leader in the conservative movement, Ronald Reagan, but why principles are probably a better focus for you than personalities. But I want to say that you saw the film or the video last night of our college conference last week, and we were blessed to have just wonderful speakers. That is really our signature program. That was a program that's longest standing for Young America's Foundation. And we had Vice President Pence, we had Senator Rand Paul, we had Senator Mike Lee, we had Dennis Prager, Newt Gingrich, Kellyanne Conway, tremendous list, Dinesh D'Souza, of speakers. But I have to, and so those are some of the big names. And if you come to our college conferences in the days ahead, you will hear more of those big names. This conference, you're blessed to hear from, I think, the two finest professors that have consistently spoken to conservative students through the years. And I don't want you to overlook the importance both of Bert Folsom and of Paul Kengor. These are two of the clearest, they're very different communicators, but they're two of the most important conservative faculty members in the country today. To stick out the time in your career serving on college faculties where you have great hostility towards you is a great indication of the dedication of these men. Bert Folsom currently, or did teach at Hillsdale College. He's just wrapping that up, but he didn't begin at Hillsdale. He began at Murray State, where a lot of the leftist professors didn't like him, harassed him, and he's an individual that really stuck with it. So you're really blessed. You're going to hear two lectures from each, but I got to tell you, they're the finest we have in terms of communicating conservative ideas, and I hope you enjoy those individuals. I'm sure you will. Today I want to begin, before we get to the student portion, which is the main portion, with some slides that show you what we're up against. These will be indications of what your fellow classmates see and think about conservatives in absence of your intervention, in absence of talking about the conservative values. And so I'm going to show you mostly covers of Time magazine. There's a few covers of Newsweek, but these are representative of what the news media, or how the news media portrays conservatives and liberals. So let me begin with 8 slides about liberals who, when they either come on the national scene or they merit attention of a news weekly, the covers are very positive. And they're very representative, not of just 8 covers, but of hundreds of covers for similar liberals under similar circumstances. Now, your first thought might be, can you judge a magazine or a book by its cover? Normally, the answer to that is no. It's almost a cliche that the answer to that is no. But the editors of Time magazine will admit that they want Time judged by its cover. They will also tell you, as they have told me, that they're the one place in the country where you can really go and have a neutral point of view, where you don't have it shaded one way or the other. Well, you're going to have to make your judgment. So I'm going to show you initially 8 slides of prominent liberals, then 11 slides of attacks on conservatives, and then we're going to look at the both the Obama administration very briefly and covers of Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. So that will give it some sort of symmetry, and then I think the point probably will be made. Well, the first that I would show you is typical of when liberals are nominated or are in the public light. This is a very good cover. 2 terrific smiles from John Kerry and Senator Edwards. Of course, they were the presidential ticket in 2004. But that's a very typical positive cover, the Sunshine Boys. Elizabeth Warren is more in the news now. But who's afraid of Elizabeth Warren? Of course, conservatives don't particularly admire her principles, the ideas that she's promoting, which is a relentless promoting socialism. Conservatives are critical of the idea that she claimed to be a Native American when she wasn't, to take part of the rigged admissions slots at Harvard University. So she falsified her background, deprived someone who really was a Native American from having a faculty position so she could advance her career. But who's afraid of Elizabeth Warren? Bernie Sanders, there's something reassuring for me that you would have an old grandfather type being popular with young people. But of course, they're not talking about him as a grandfather. They're talking about him as promoting socialism. So socialize this. Again, smiling face, a very happy cover. I'm going to contrast these with how conservatives are treated in just a moment. Now, the next picture, you know, if you're into lookism, Ruth Bader Ginsburg is probably not the most beautiful woman that's been in public life. But so factor that in. She's a brilliant advocate of a liberal point of view. So I could say positive things about her. I disagree with her philosophy. But she was portrayed as an icon. So you're not going to see Justice Clarence Thomas or Associate Justice Alito or even Gorsuch portrayed in a pretty positive, straightforward as an icon. Justice Sotomayor, again, a smiling face. Latina justice, will she change the court? 4 Supreme Court miss. These are, again, when liberals come on the scene, how they're positively portrayed. How many of you in your high school education have seen the film An Inconvenient Truth? Not many. So that was a very much required in most high schools across the country when it first came out. It was Al Gore's film about climate change. And in the film, there's a sequel to it now, but in the film, Al Gore had predicted, for example, by the year 2014, all the snow would be gone from Mount Kilimanjaro. He predicted that by 2016, there would be no more ice in the Arctic ice cap. So this has led a lot of conservatives to think that the climate change advocates are trying to cook the books, are trying to dupe the American people. and have been very critical of their point of view. But Newsweek portrayed Al Gore as the thinking man's thinking man. So very, very positive. This is the smartest of the smart, according to Newsweek. And then oftentimes when there's other people in the mainline news media, they reinforce them positively. I just give you one example of that. When Katie Couric was moving to the nightly news, wonderful smile, suggesting she will shine in nightly news. Didn't last very long. Didn't work out. But this is the treatment that you get when liberals come on the scene. And then one issue, I largely stick with personalities, but this says it all. This was not too long ago, but we're all socialists now. The perils and promise of a new era of big government. Suggesting that all of us should be liberals or should be socialists. Well, let me move to the conservatives. Last night you heard from Babe Buchanan. She said that she was influenced by her brother, Pat. Her brother, Pat, was the communications director for Ronald Reagan during the Reagan presidency. So he has a direct tie not only to core conservative beliefs going back, as his sister said last night, to the days when he worked for Richard Nixon, but he played a very prominent role himself in the Reagan administration as the communications director for Ronald Reagan. He appeared on the cover of Time and Newsweek three times on the national level. He was portrayed as a hellraiser, preaching fear, and bully boy. So these are how your fellow classmates would see in the news treatments of conservatives. Newt Gingrich, who spoke to our conference last week, first appeared on the cover of Time magazine as mad as hell. When he became elected as speaker, even before he assumed the speakership, he was portrayed as Uncle Scrooge. It's the season to bash the poor. But is Newt Gingrich's America really that heartless? So again, portraying conservative ideas and conservative personalities extremely negatively right from the get-go. Rush Limbaugh is a pretty effective communicator, very popular. He's been portrayed on the covers four times, all of them negative. This was the first Rush Limbaugh screaming into the microphone. The last one actually showed tape over his mouth and something like shutting up Rush Limbaugh. I showed you the Democratic ticket in 2004. This is an example of how Republicans portrayed. Nice smile by Governor Bush or President Bush, but they're portrayed as the Avengers, not the Sunshine Boys, as you saw the Democratic candidates. Ted Cruz. Ted Cruz is portrayed on the covers once, and he's portrayed as likable enough, using a very unusual picture of Ted Cruz. Believe me, this is nothing like the Sunshine Boys you saw a little bit before. Michelle Bachman, my assistant from Minnesota, she helped me put these slides together. She insisted on putting her former congressman, Michelle Bachman, a very prominent spokesman for conservative ideas. She said there's a double negative in this picture, because not only does it use a lousy picture of Michelle Bachman, who's a pretty good-looking woman, but also portrayed her as the queen of rage. Governor Christie, you're familiar with. You can only imagine how they would want to portray Governor Christie. The news media is relentless attacking him. He's the elephant in the room. You know, people can say maybe my comments about lookism were inappropriate, but you knew something like this was probably going to come. Vice President Cheney served this country admirably. There were a lot of accusations against him. None of them ever proved out to be true. This was relating to Valerie Plame supposedly being a secret agent. She was no longer a secret agent. They suggested that he was involved in exposing her. He was not, turned out. But they still wanted to portray him as the verdict on Cheney with a cloud over him, like the like he was guilty, even though it was just incorrect attacks on him. I now want to shift to the Obama administration, and then I'm going to give you head-to-head comparisons between Hillary and Donald Trump. You can only imagine. But before I get to the heart of the Obama administration, one person in the Obama administration who generally in Washington is considered to be an absolute joke is Joe Biden. Joe Biden was most people commonly felt was chosen as the vice president by Obama because no one would ever want to make him president of the United States. So he didn't have to worry about, you know, being impeached or anything like that because his backup was someone that most people thought, you know, was one of the most light-thinking and light-headed individuals in Washington. So that was a problem for Joe Biden. But Newsweek portrays why Joe Biden is no joke. From Afghanistan to healthcare, he's the vice president to be reckoned with. So you could contrast that with the one you just saw for Dick Cheney. Now moving to Barack Obama. Before Barack Obama was even a United States senator, so when he was a state senator in Illinois, give the magazines credit for identifying him as an up-and-coming leader, but he was portrayed for the first time as a state senator as seeing purple. What do you think that means?
He's in the middle?
Yes. Why is it in the middle being purple?
Because it's a blend of Democrat and Republican.
So it's a blend of red and blue. So this, from the very beginning, he is the person that's presented who's going to unite the United States. He's going to be a healer to the divisions in our country. And those themes, I'm going to give you just a few examples of Obama, but believe me, there are scores of them, at least 40 covers that are positive about Barack Obama. The next president, this was long before he became president, why he could be the next president. They're already portraying him in that role. When in the presidential campaign, he was criticized as not having much experience, only having served in the United States Senate for less than 2 years before he started running for president. They wrote, had this experience matter. He did get elected, and I have no problem with giving the president of the United States, particularly newly elected, a very favorable cover. The American people just elected him. But this one should tell you a lot, why Obama's critics are so dumb. Right? So who could criticize this guy? Who, you know, the last 8 years have been nirvana. So if you're critical of him, you are so dumb. Now we'll shift to Hillary. This is before she was a United States Senator. This is as former First Lady. She's presented as her turn. Like, automatically, she should have the Senate seat from the state of New York, where she never lived, she never grew up, she never went to school, but it's her turn to take a United States Senate seat. Senate or world stage at that particular point. So again, you're going to see very positive ones. This is Hillary, Women of the Year. Again, a dazzling smile. If you go back for a second, you see her brown eyes. She found out that polling, it's better to have blue eyes, so she changed her contacts. If you haven't ever noticed that on Hillary before, that's part of Hillary. She, like Obama, used a lot of polling. Consistently positive, what Hillary believes, why she'll think she'll win. I found my voice. Hear her roar, gender, class, and Hillary Clinton. I'll give you two more of Hillary, and then we'll shift to the Donald. The fighter, how she came back, and why it could be too late. This was against, Obama, or was it against, I guess it was against Obama. It was too late in that particular case. But these are very typical, very, very positive. Hillary Clinton and the rise of smart power, consistently portraying Hillary Clinton in the most positive ways, consistently portraying liberals in the most positive way possible. Now, let's turn to Donald Trump. You can only imagine where this is going, because this is what you see, and this is part of the reason why he's in a battle with the news media all the time. The art of the bad deal, both Time and Newsweek had a cover along those lines. Looks like he's giving America the finger there. Donald explains business flops. This one is a fairly recent one. Bully, showman, party crasher, demagogue? Should he be the 45th president of the United States? The picture answers itself, right? There's so many negative ones on Donald Trump. Deal with it.
I like
do you like that one, huh?
Yeah. It's
almost like it's boring. So he was chosen as the person of the year. For some reason, they've got a fascination of showing him from behind. When that does, I don't exactly get that. He's coming to Washington, incoming. Who comes from a military family? What does incoming mean? What does it mean? TAC, artillery. Usually artillery is coming and is going to hit your position. Incoming, that means duck. Protect yourself from the threat. His war on Washington, crumbling one of George Washington's monument. Nothing here to see, suggesting that he doesn't really care, he doesn't read memos, the White House staff, he's just oblivious, he just doesn't care, everything just blows by in terms of any reports in that to him. These are two famous ones from last year, early in the campaign. Meltdown, Donald Trump said some things different than the average political leader would say, so it's portrayed as a meltdown, his campaign is basically over, but of course it wasn't over, so it's total meltdown. So in case you missed the point the first time, total meltdown for the Donald. His hotel, which is a spectacular hotel, they associate completely with the swamp, which the swamp, of course, is normally referred to Washington's corruption, Washington's inner city. They're suggesting that the inner part of government, that his hotel is the epitome of that. They're trying to, of course, say that the White House was run by Russia at the outset, so there's the White House being taken over by the Kremlin. So no subtlety in that particular cover of Time magazine. And then one of a speaker for the foundation, you're going to see a film that he produced, Still Point, and on Ronald Reagan's ranch before the weekend's over. He's produced three films for Young America's Foundation, but he is the chief counsel to the advisor to the President of the United States, Steve Bannon. He's portrayed as the great manipulator. So again, this is someone that has spoken here, has started his films here, you're going to see his films. And then, of course, there's been relentless attack also on the President's family. I'll just give you an example. This is Donald Trump Jr. caught red-handed because he took a meeting, but basically portraying him as guilty. Another aspect of this that you should pay attention to is it's in black and white. When things are in black and white, they're normally viewed by your generation as more sinister or more old, but usually more sinister. So when they shift to black and white, you got to know that they're manipulating it somewhat. I think I probably made my point. Conservatives are manipulators. Got a Donald Trump looking your life is going to be very much troubled and you have to deal with it. People like Newt Gingrich, mad as hell, up against people like Elizabeth Warren or Barack Obama, time has come, or Hillary Clinton, smart power. What all this suggests is not a lot, what I suggest to me is there's not a lot of confidence in the underlying liberals' ideas. Time and Newsweek, but especially Time, they wouldn't have to do this. This is almost cartoonish. This is attacking straw men, straw women, trying to lead their audience, not giving you a balanced idea, not coming to grips with what liberals and conservatives' point of view, but trying to taint the jury pool, if you will, to use a legal term, so that by the time your fellow classmates begin to consider ideas, they've already absorbed this. The conservatives are queen of rage, mad as hell, manipulators, bully boys, preaching fear, hellraisers. All very negative terms where smart power and one of a kind and the icon and all these wonderful things that liberals are. You don't do that if you want an honest debate. You do that when you want to completely control the debate. You do that when you're trying to lead your audiences, not really educate your audiences. And this is why understanding conservative principles is so important. Because if you start out with just personalities, the pool has already been prejudiced against you. So you need to start out, I think, with the principles, the ideas that you believe in. And that's what this particular session is all about. So let's delve into what you decided were important conservative principles. This was the last group to report, so we'll let that be last, probably. Who has the Chris Christie group, the elephant in the room group? Who is that? You're the speaker. Why don't you come forward? Did you realize the elephant in the room was a reference to Chris Christie?
Yeah, I saw that.
You did see that back then. How are you doing? Ron Robinson.
Nice to meet you.
Good to have you with us. You need to use the microphone so that they can see you all across the country on national television. I don't want to make you nervous about it or anything like that.
No, not nervous.
Tell me what, give me three of the most important points of your group, of what are conservative values to you.
Well, I'd say
give me one at a time, if you will.
I'd say that the most important one on there is just individual rights. At the end of the day, we as conservatives believe that the individual, it triumphs over the collective values that liberals champion many times, that we as individuals are the most important unit of our democracy. Beyond that, you have economic libertarianism. Our government should stay out of our economy, and we should be allowed to do as we please, invest how we please, and not have it dictated to us by a regulatory board in Washington. Finally, there's a number of important ones on there, but patriotism. All of us distinctly support our country. We're there on the 4th of July with our America flag, hats, flags, everything, and we love our country as conservatives.
Well, let's probe that idea of individualism. Do you think that still works in the 21st century? I mean, the Founding Fathers came at a time when America was smaller and you could have the rugged individuals, but this is a complex society. Don't you think the individual has to give way to group identity and collectives at this time?
Definitely not. The individual is more important than ever, and we're seeing that especially with the 2016 election, where places like Pennsylvania, Ohio, Wisconsin, Michigan, the individual took back their voice from people just saying, you have to follow what the government tells you. An individual vote matters. Your individual choices matter to you, to your family, and the individual should in no way and will never secede itself and its authority to a collective.
So you have individualism at the first, you have economic libertarianism. What does libertarianism mean to you?
Well, it believes, for me, libertarianism really means that we tell the government to stay out. That we, for the economic context, we tell the government that we want independence, we want the ability to manage how we control our money and what companies do with their money, how they invest, and we want to form relationships economically, not based on a government directive.
All right, Alexander. Any questions for Alexander on that? Who was in the group that was the returners that were learning the liberal or emphasizing liberal attacks? What would the liberals say to him on that? Of individualism. What would be the liberal critique of individualism? Do you think liberals think they're supporting liberal individualism?
I have to say no, because when it comes to the liberals and individualism, they don't technically care about the individual unless they're asking for another bathroom or they're asking for something that's just out of the norm. And when it comes to individualism, they're more focused on their group and what the group wants, and they're going to focus on the group's emotion before they go to that.
Can I pass it down? Sure.
I think they try to portray what they're doing as that, like, they care about your individual, like, oh, like, you, like, as a transgender, like, we care about you, so we want to do this. But what they're actually doing is more beneficial to their group as a whole, but they're disguising it that, like, they care about each individual.
Those are excellent points. Any other points? You have one over here? I'm going to pass the microphone down and wait till you have the microphone so the nationwide audience can hear your point.
I think they're trying to instill like a group feel. Like they want us not to be, you know, They want a united like thing where everyone has the same opinion, but it doesn't. But they don't allow for different opinions, and that's a problem with liberals. They don't listen to other opinions because they all have this group mindset that doesn't allow individuals to speak out about their own beliefs and opinions.
Those are good points. I think they all three of them reinforce why the point you make may be important to your fellow students. They probably want to live their own lives. The idea of individualism is still popular. People may try to drive you off the point, saying it was something of the past, that it's not appropriate now. But we have a hint here that it may resonate with your fellow students. We may have one more critic before I let you go.
Okay.
Pass that across if you would.
The core of liberalism is culturalism. All of liberalism is focused on what is the world seeing now and how can we better the world with what the world view is. It's all about moving forward with what everyone is agreeing upon. Everyone is seeing, you know, transgenderism, you know, that's the new big thing, so we'll focus on that. Whenever the next big thing comes forward, whatever it may be, whether it's, you know, legalizing pedophilia or reinforcing ideas that are now coming into the nation. It's all about the culture. It's not about the people.
Good. I appreciate you adding to that. We're going to come back probably under one of the other boards as well to some of the transgender issues. But Alexander, I appreciate it.
Yep.
Sounds like you had a good group.
Yep.
Thank you very much. For now, I'm going to skip over the returners. I'm going to try to use returners as critics of this. Who is a spokesman for the Respect Dignity of Individual Life group? Why don't you come forward? I'll put that down for a second. How are you, Ron Robinson?
Nice to meet you.
Great to have you with us. Why don't you bring out a couple of the most important points for your group, if you would?
Okay, so respecting the dignity of individual life in terms of pro-life movements, equality of opportunity, not equality of outcome, and we said preserving traditional values in the founding principles, like in our Constitution and our Bill of Rights, such as the right to citizens' militia, freedom of speech, And
all right, let's talk about equality of opportunity rather than equality of outcome. If you're poor and you don't have enough to eat, how's that person going to enjoy equality of opportunity?
Well, for example, my family, they came from nothing. They lived in a little house and they were able to work their way up the system, and now they own very nice houses and have a good life. I think equality of opportunity makes it so that we can offer the basic things that we need in order to have the people who work hard achieve great things, and people who don't work as hard don't achieve as much. In terms of food, I don't think we have a really big crisis with food.
I think you're right on that. I agree with that. Yeah. I was just trying to see how you would answer that. You're probably going to get some of those questions when you contrast the two. There is a really big push from the left today for equality in results.
Yeah.
What would you say to a leftist as the main argument against it, other than your family's success coming from more difficult circumstances to success in American life? As a general, well, here's one of the things the left would say. This is the philosophy of John Rawls, who basically says you have to project yourself back, not knowing how you're going to be born, not knowing your circumstances. You could be born, with great physical handicap. You could be born in a society where people look down on you because you're from the wrong ethnic group or something like that. And how do we construct a society, not knowing in advance where we're going to be, but that's fair to all people? That's a big liberal argument, big liberal case for that particular point of view. Conservatives, you're right, talk about individuals not necessarily having equal results at the end. But what is the case for inequality in the end? I may be working just as hard as, Bill Gates, but, I don't have the big mansions in Seattle and elsewhere around the country.
I think
how is that fair?
I think it's also about working smart, not necessarily just always pushing to work hard. Just taking different opportunities when you have them, and having some faith. I think the problem with the wage gap is where that is being reflected a lot today. And I think also just people's tendencies, what people like and don't like has a big effect on maybe how the polls may look. I think there was an article that came out, it was actually just on Fox News this morning, about the guy who worked for Google, and he was talking about how in the tech industry, why there's more males, and about human just natural tendencies. I think that can also have a big impact on just where you see people in mm-hmm. general.
I think part of the answer, too, I think you hit on some of it, part of the answer is whether or not people produce products and goods that other people want, which is generally a good thing in society. So Bill Gates produced software and systems that lifted the lives of millions of people. I only lift the lives of 90 high school students. So of course he's going to be enumerated for that. Bruce Springsteen or the Rolling Stones or U2, my sons always say I use much too old examples, and I'll readily concede that. But those bands produced more of an audience that followed them. And so we incentivized. More people are going to have the kind of music they want, in part because there is this inequality. There is this potential for a band to be much more successful. Someone might open a corner drugstore, but someone might take a greater chance and open Walgreens and invest all across the country and take chances that way. And they may be able to serve more people than you would expect that. So that's part of the results of inequality that are positive. The left assumes inequality is horrible, that inequality is in terms of economic results, is inherently bad. But you probably want to incentivize people to produce products and services that serve a broader audience. Bert Folsom probably going to touch on this, some of the robber barons and how they were vilified in your history textbooks, but they really provided services that transformed the world in a very positive way. I think that's overlooked. People are going to hammer you about, won't you be for a $15 minimum wage? That will be one of the issues the left will ask you about on your campuses. And as young people in high schools, you probably would prefer to make $15 an hour as compared to what you might be making now. What's the downside of that?
Well, I think competition will just create the ability for jobs to just have the wage that's fair. I think a big problem is with immigration is when we have more people coming here, and there's inherently just less, there's more people, so there's less of a demand to have a higher wage, because especially with illegal workers, they work for a lot less. And so that also definitely is part of the problem. If we had a system where there wasn't a minimum wage enforced, but we didn't have the illegal immigrants coming, I think that would just naturally just increase the wage people were making.
Yeah. I think also on that, sometimes an employer is not going to be able to hire as many young people as they want if it's $15 an hour. So other people miss the opportunities to have their startup job. My father's store was like that. He had a number of employees that were making minimum wage, but when the wage was raised high enough in New York State, he eliminated non-family members. He didn't have to pay family members a minimum wage. So I had to work for almost nothing. But that was his response. Today, some people have that response. Some people then bring in technology that replaces those jobs. The first job is very important. It gives you some work habits. You find out you need to show up and items like that. But the left will play that. Why should people make less than $15 an hour? Isn't that unfair? You need to be prepared for that. Anything else you want to bring out? Any questions for? Yes. I'll give you the microphone here. Maybe you should keep it. No, just kidding. Sorry.
I just wanted to play a devil's advocate and use an argument that the
my leftist snowflakes like to bring. And that's when it comes to personal responsibility and individual independence, that's something key in the conservative movement. But yet, when it talks about gay rights and stuff, they say, oh, no, but it's my individual independence to love who I love. So how can you counter that when we so much on individual independence, but yet if you don't support gay rights, you're deemed a fascist, a bigot? So how do you counter that?
Well, I've heard Ben Shapiro say, does a child deserve to have a mother and a father? As an argument, personally, I think if you want to marry a dude and you're a dude, you should just do it. But that's an unpopular argument. But yeah, I think talking about how marriage encourages the raising of children, and then it encourages their rights to having a better life, a stabler life, is an argument you could use.
We'll pick up some of those social arguments as we move on and the other boards. Anything else you want to bring out on your board in particular?
Well,
you didn't deal with the social issues much, but we'll probably pick those up.
I mean, I think another important thing is the citizens' militia.
Mm-hmm.
That's definitely not talked about, especially with gun control. We see this repeatedly as you have peaceful nations, relatively peaceful, and then they're outweaponed by some invading nation, and then the people are just completely wiped out and killed. And I think that's what the Founding Fathers trying to do when they created the citizens' militia, or they created the right to bear arms. That was a right, so.
Good.
That's something else that's important. Good. But
I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Okay. Who represented Group 5? How are you doing?
Good.
Good to have you back.
Thank you. So,
why don't you bring out some items that have not been brought out. So if your top items have already been discussed a little bit, bring out a couple others.
We agreed with the first speaker that individual liberty is a huge factor in the conservative beliefs. And then our second one, we said the idea of a limited government or a smaller government, so less government involvement in our daily lives.
Limited government, yep.
And then our third one was the idea of a free market economy and how that is also beneficial to America as a whole and helps everyone.
Well, let's zero in on limited government. Why don't you give me a couple of the arguments that you think are important for limited government?
With less government involvement in our daily lives, it can really help in allowing us to be more free in what we do, and can also help in the free market aspect, as in economics and all that. With less regulation and taxation on production and producing more goods, it can allow for a more prosperous economy and allow America to flourish.
But the Founding Fathers promoted limited government back in the 18th century, when the country was only 3 million people, all lived on the eastern seaboard. Government could be limited then because people lived far away. They didn't live all packed together. Don't you have to have more government as the society becomes larger?
That is incorrect.
Why is it incorrect?
Because when in this aspect of a bigger or smaller government, they're basically just giving the government more control or less control. So you can have a smaller government that still enforces the same laws over the whole mass amount of people as it continues to grow and become larger. But with the idea of a bigger government, it is the idea of more government involvement in our daily lives. So it's not that the government itself isn't like expanding to meet the needs of a rising population. It's the idea that the government is entering our lives and becoming more intrusive on our daily
more
lives.
Intrusive. Anyone else want to add to why we should support limited government or question limited government? Yep. Give Drew another argument, one way or the other.
Well, you look at a number of societies which have turned away from forms of limited government. Germany during the 1930s and 40s, the Soviet Union, and you can see time and time again, big government takes away from the individual liberties of people. At the end of the day, when you have a large government, people are suppressed, and people are unable to economically develop, individually develop, and they're quite stunted in a form of development of their psyche and their wallets.
Because they depend on government making decisions for them?
Right, yeah.
Rather than making themselves? Nathan?
And often comes to that people assume that bigger government equals better government, that the government knows how to provide for healthcare and other stuff like that, when in actuality, they don't, they're not efficient at it. In the military, we have TRICARE, and it's very, very ineffective. It's run by the government, and it doesn't work very well. And that's why, you know, we pushed for companies to provide for it and, you know, insurance, because they know how to do it, because they can act quickly and efficiently versus the government, which is slow and bureaucratic and has to pass a ton of laws to get stuff done.
Yep. Anyone else want to make a, we'll go here and then right behind you as well.
Yeah, I'd like to, wanted to expand on the, about the government on healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why it doesn't work is because the government,
it's all right.
About the microphone. But the reason why it doesn't work when the government does it is because the government is a third-party buyer. So they're not using their own money because it comes from other people through taxes. And also, they don't benefit from the product. They're not getting the product. And the third-party buyer is like the worst possible buyer you can get because no matter what they spend it on, they don't care about the value. They don't care about the price. It's not their money. So you're not going to get quality health care. It's not going to work out.
Good. It's a good point. Milton Friedman would agree with that.
Yep. So I would say, I'm like, if you're playing devil's advocate,
right?
A lot of liberals, a lot of people on the left say, like, limited government is bad because, you know, you look at countries in Europe, they give the example of, like, Scandinavian countries like Norway and Sweden. They say, well, they, you know, they're, you know, by all accounts socialist, and they're, it's, you know, it's peachy over there. I mean, that's the left's argument, you know, so it's like how do you combat that, basically?
What would you say to that, Drew? Is it peachy over there?
I'd say that when they have a very, very limited government where there's almost no government involvement in the people's lives at all, it can get kind of sketchy, because when the people are basically running under anarchy and there's not much enforcement of the laws that are set in place, it can allow for almost too much freedom, and it can allow for like groups to come up and rise up within the countries that take more control, and then those groups take control over the less advocated for people. So they take and make their own power under the government without being regulated by the government.
Yeah, I think it's a myth about the Nordic countries. First, they have been moving away from the social welfare system. One of the things you always have to remember is America, more so than even Europe today, although Europe today has changed and allows more people in. Maybe Israel fits this description to some extent. But the United States pulls people from all over the world. The number of immigrants, even legal immigrants, in our country is oftentimes very high. And when you compare the United States on certain measures against a stable population, that you have to really compare stable American families to the other country you're comparing it with. If you factor in the immigrants, oftentimes they're going to have less wealth at first. Oftentimes they're not as healthy at first. And therefore, that will skew some of the statistics. The only way the Scandinavian countries even come close is by ignoring that factor. But there are other factors in Scandinavia. You probably know many of them. The suicide rate is very high. The populations are very restricted. People think of places like Sweden as being very open. It's very restricted where you live. You can't live in Stockholm if you're basically an immigrant. There's very different. The left in the United States ignores all that. A critical look at the Scandinavian countries would lead you with a very different impression than what the news media. Just as the news media distorts some of the personalities, oftentimes they'll distort the underlying reality in other countries. You'll want to meet with and talk with free market people from Scandinavia. They will be a big help to you. There are free market groups in all those countries. They'll give you some of the answers to that. Let me give you one other general argument. Maybe you can add to it, Drew, if you want. And then I want to give you, as a group, one more example of where freedom, you're all going to agree, your fellow students are going to agree that we ought to have freedom. one of the reasons Americans become much more divided today is because as government controls more decisions, whether it be healthcare or be education, whether it be how much water is in your toilet or what kind of light bulb you use, you end up fighting or how to treat transgender or traditional American families, whether we should have prayer in school or not, all these type of issues. As government decides more and more of those issues, Americans end up being divided. It becomes a zero-sum game where you're fighting with the same people. And it becomes a much more divided and much more cantankerous society. When you make most of those decisions for yourselves, you only can get upset with yourself making the wrong decision. You don't get upset that Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump or Barack Obama or Governor Brown made those decisions for you. So unlimited government leads to more divided country, more contentious, because you're having to go to Washington or go to Sacramento to fight for what you want instead of just making those decisions yourself. Is that a way of putting some of your ideas that you expressed?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Keep that in mind. Anything else you want to bring out?
No.
Thank you very much. I'm moving probably too slowly, but I want to give you one example where all your fellow students would agree with the conservative approach, the individualist approach, as compared to liberal cliches and liberal ideas. And that is in music. If I asked this group and took time, ask how many tunes each of you have in your, whatever you're using to play your music, you're going to have a wide range. Based on prior examples, it can go from, 100 or 200 tunes to some people having thousands of tunes. Great inequality. But you probably don't worry about that at night. You may want more music for yourself, but it's not something you resent that Drew has 5,000 tunes in his iPod or whatever he's using these days. Entertainment groups become unemployed as they don't succeed, as the marketplace moves on. Some bands fall by the wayside and live poorly. Others live lavish lifestyle, make unlimited money. You don't lose sleep over that. A few companies control the tickets to concerts. There's some griping about that, but it is true. And a few labels control who gets published, if you use that term, for music, who gets on the award shows and those type of things. There's an elite and then there's less successful. But the point is, you don't want government controlling the music you listen to. You don't want them controlling the music industry. You don't want them, when you have new ideas or new music you want to listen to, that you have to go to Senator Brown or Senator Feinstein to lobby for that, right? You want to make that decision yourself.
Yep.
So that's an argument for limited government that all your fellow students would understand. Something that affects their lives, there's inequality in it, there may be a few groups that control the market, but even with those inequities, you're still going to be better off making those decisions for yourself. That, I think, is an example you can use for limited government. The Screaming Eagles. Was that the 82nd Airborne or 101st? What's the Screaming Eagles? 101st, okay. Is your family tied to the 101st Airborne?
I don't think so.
Their nickname is the Screaming Navy, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Why don't you bring out what was important to your group?
Well, I think everyone said limited government.
Tell the group your name again, Nathan.
Oh, sorry, Nathan, yeah. I think everyone said limited government already, but I guess I'll say a couple others. But legal, immigration, God-given rights, and free markets are a couple others. But
God-given rights. What was the legal?
Legal immigration.
Let's talk about God-given rights. What does that mean?
And
how does it differ from what the left would say?
Well, the left would say that the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence grants us rights, and that it's not the case. They protect the government from barring taking those rights away, because those rights were not given to us by the government, they were given to us by God.
So they precede government. Yes. So the First Amendment doesn't give us the right of free speech. It guarantees the government will not interfere in the right of free speech.
That's right.
That's an important concept. Nathan's, that's core to the difference between conservative beliefs and liberal beliefs. Liberals think government grants these rights. Conservatives and the Founding Fathers believe you had those rights by your Christian heritage, perhaps, but by your innate human nature, and that government is endowed to protect those rights, but they don't decide those rights. They protect them. A little bit of legal immigration. What do you mean by that?
Well, if you want to come to this country, you will have to go through a process to become a citizen of the United States. And, you know, the left would argue that, oh, well, the people fleeing to the United States that don't have the time to go through the process. But honestly, it's a process that you need to go through. My great-grandfather was an Italian immigrant, and he worked hard to become an American citizen. And now it's funny, because he'll be calling, you know, company, and then it'll say, press 2 for Espanol, and he'll be complaining because he had to learn English to be in this country, and now there's people who don't learn the...
He wouldn't have been happy if they said press 3 for Italian?
No? Well, if you had to work hard to learn English, and you spent your time and put so much effort to become an American citizen, and then you see people who come to this country and don't go through that same process to show that they're prideful to become an American and just come just for to get the benefits rather than work to become deserve those benefits as an American, then it's kind of ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. So you want the legal process as compared to illegal? You're for immigration, but not...
I am for immigration. We are a nation of immigrants, but that doesn't mean you should be cheating the process and coming here illegally.
All right, anyone want to comment on any of that? Well, the left has said it. All right, let me get...
Can I comment?
No, you've commented already.
Oh, okay.
We'll try a couple different ones. No, I'll come back to you. I'm sorry.
It's actually very true about the importance of working to become an American citizen. I imagine many of you have watched Waters World, but he was interviewing some Democrat he came across on the street who was Hispanic, and he was not born in the United States. He came here through the legal immigration process, and he was, you know, straight up, you know, the typical liberal point of view. However, when he came to the illegal immigration issue, he did, you know, the man noticeably became upset because he had to go through the legal immigration process. He believed in it, and he was upset that other people, even from his country, were coming in and not having to do that process. He thought it was wrong, so...
So that's a clear split between illegal and illegal. Yes.
I feel like the left has kind of distorted our view on immigration. They believe that we don't care about the individual and that we don't care about their rights. But what we actually want is people to assimilate to us. I mean, if you compare assimilation in Europe and in America, Europe's culture has been destroyed. It has all become one influx of a destructive culture that hates each other instead of what we want in America, where we can all be one unit and type of person and we can agree with each other and work together as a nation instead of what's been happening in most other countries that just allow people to come in, where their culture collides and they've sort of been taken over by people who don't assimilate.
Any other...
One argument that I often hear from the leftist side, and I'm kind of playing devil's advocate here, is that if you say that everyone has to immigrate legally, do you just want to expel all the illegal immigrants from the country? Or should they be allowed to stay and we just close our borders now? And yeah, this is just playing devil's advocate.
What would you say to that, Nathan?
Well, they have built a life here, and that is a problem because they are individual people, and they have worked. You know, they are trying to provide a life for themselves. But their problem is they haven't got. It's like they're still technically breaking the law, and you have to follow the law to become a United States citizen.
Let's pick up some that haven't said anything already.
I think the key word in illegal immigrants is illegal. So.
Sounds like you should have been up there representing the group.
They got to do the same thing as we do in our everyday lives. So if we pay taxes, they do too.
Exactly. Yes.
Another, liberals or leftists will also use this as a counter, as like an argument, saying like, "Oh, you know, well, America was built on immigrants, and you're just an immigrant too, because you came from Europe to settle here, and you stole the land from Native Americans, and these other crazy things." And you know, what would you be your counter argument to those kind of things too?
That's a good question.
Well, when my great grandparents came to this country, they worked to become immigrants, and they worked. To become legal immigrants, and they started from the bottom, and they worked hard in this country because this is a country of equal opportunities, and they rose and they worked and they became where they are today.
Well, let this be the final on immigration. I'll offer something, but go ahead.
I just want to say, the whole immigration topic, I'm more for assimilating to our culture and our values here in the West. You know, I know Babe Buchanan yesterday, she mentioned trading and trading with countries that share our values and share our culture here, like Europe and Canada and things like that. And I'm more for immigration from those different countries because I know here in the West and here in the United States, you know, we share cultural values, and I know from different countries like Mexico and Saudi Arabia and the Middle East, they don't share our culture, they don't share our values. So I think if we're going to have people from those countries come over here, I think there needs to be assimilation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to add before I...
I want to comment on his a bit. I do agree a little bit. I believe, you have to... It's good to bring some aspect of your culture from your country. I don't believe you... I mean, you should... suit to the ideas and the laws of the nation, but you can, I do believe, keeping a little bit of the culture. There's a difference, however, between culture and the laws. There are Muslims in Michigan who are trying to bring Sharia law into Michigan, and that is not what we are for. We are America. We have our own laws. We have our own culture, and you can bring some culture from here, but we have to follow American laws and systems.
I think that's a good point. Thank you, Nathan. Appreciate it. Thank you. Obviously, the group has strong opinions on this issue. Let me just give you a couple other concepts. I do think it's a valid point to make the distinction between legal and illegal immigration. But I've sponsored, my wife and I have sponsored someone under the legal system, a woman that husband had worked for the American Embassy in Ghana and came to the United States because the Marxists took over that country. And we sponsored her. And the legal system is a very bad system, not in the sense that one should violate the laws, but understand that the legal system is very tough to get through. It involves a lot of legal assistance, involves a considerable wait and time. So there probably need to be reforms in the legal system, even from a conservative point of view. The second is I personally think that our country has benefited and can benefit from a diversity of population. There is different generations that will have different ideas on this. But my grandparents came from Ireland, and many of the same points were made about them, that they didn't share exactly the same values as the American people. They actually shared the language in English. They grew up in, for the most part, a British-ruled country, but their religious values were very different than the Protestant majority in the country at that particular time, and they were portrayed as very, very different people. But ultimately, with the Italians and the Poles, but these different layers came to a country that actually, the point was made, did a much better job of assimilating people to American values. I think that some of the countries that you listed do have much closer to American values. Some are much further away, and those are factors that one should take into consideration. But I think that, honestly, I think there's a big difference between Mexicans who have grown up in the Americas and much more close to our ideas and system of government than Saudi Arabia. So there are differences that one may make, but I would be much more hesitant personally to take a Saudi in a society that doesn't assimilate people very well, who may believe in Sharia law. Not only Sharia law in the sense of maybe they become a majority and they pass it, but they're enforcing it in their communities in contra to the existing American rule of law. So those are some factors that you ought to consider. If you are hesitant to have much immigration, one argument that is significantly overlooked by the left, except maybe sometimes environmentalists, is that yes, all Americans basically, unless they were enslaved people, came to the United States as immigrants on their own volition from somewhere else, and they were admitted to the country. But the country was an empty country at that particular point. And the security risks were much less for letting open borders at that particular point. And those also were the laws of the land at that time. But a really big significant difference is when many early waves of immigrants came to this country, we needed additional population to fill out the country. That may not be as strong a need for the country today as it might have been in the 19th century. Those are just factors that you ought to have in mind. Who's group Second Amendment? Who represents that group? So you're going to get another chance at the microphone after all.
Yeah.
Woo! And you need to bring out a couple points that have not been brought out already, though.
All right.
Even if they weren't your most important.
Do I mess the most important first and then?
No, forget that. You don't have time for that. Why don't you begin with right to life?
All right. So some of our important points were we had right to life.
Talk about that for a second.
All right.
Why is right to life important? You guys talk about being conservative and believing in the individual.
Yeah.
But why don't you believe in, Bate touched a little bit this last night, why don't you believe in the individual woman making a choice for her own body?
Because what it does is, see, there's a concept in, and this is a bit more libertarian than conservative, but I guess they can kind of be one and one, the non-aggression principle, which is all like, it's a crime if it violates a life, someone's life, liberty, or property. And in the case of right to life, you're violating a child's life, his right to life, or his or her right to life. And, you know, like, as a conservative, like, you know, we're for small government, people free to make their own choices, but you gotta respect people. Like, you know, there's obviously a lot, like, you can't just go on and kill people. Like, you gotta be, you know, that's never right, obviously. So, like, the case with abortion, like, you can't just kill people, you know? Like, you need to take care of it, and if you don't want it, just give it up for adoption.
What about Roe v. Wade? You talk about the rule of law. What about Roe v. Wade? It's the rule of law.
But the problem with Roe v. Wade is that they brought some, they were trying to, because this goes into the argument about the living, breathing constitutional document. It's not living and breathing, so they were using the right to privacy, which is more for, like, you know, the government, like, getting into your house sort of thing. But they were trying to see it like, oh, well, it's her private life, her right to privacy, you know. So they were kind of trying to twist the amendment. So they didn't make a good argument for the case. That's the problem with Roe v. Wade. And even a lot of people maybe who even support abortion even admit that, yeah, there's nothing in the Constitution that says that you have the right to an abortion.
You know how many lives we lost in America because of abortions in your lifetime?
Probably dozens of millions.
Anyone know the figure?
Isn't it like 60 million? 60 million?
Right there.
18 million.
Anyone else? No, they're in the ballpark. It's about 60 million. Last I knew, it was about 52 million. So there are approximately 50 to 60 million. The numbers may have gone up. I haven't looked at the latest numbers. Lives not in existence today because of abortion in the United States since 1973. Liberal politicians, even though they talked about choice, said they would make abortions less frequent. That has not happened. When we talk about core values of the conservative movement, I'm surprised we waited this long and didn't have it circled it is one of the most important things the conservative movement's doing today. If you want to be proud to be in a conservative, it's because you're protecting people that can't protect themselves. And it's an absolutely core conservative belief. Yes.
Thank you. One of the great ironies about the liberals' point of view on the right to life is that when the child is in the mother's womb, she has the right to do whatever she wants to it. But when the child is grown and is in elementary school or high school, the parent has no right to control its medical treatment, to see medical records, and other things like that.
Yeah. There are inconsistencies the left has on this issue, to say the least. Let me give you a shot, and then we'll move on to another topic because we need to wind down.
That figure is important to look at in the United States because 50 million is a very large number, but I think it's also important to look at a worldwide number because there are like countries in Europe that are pressuring African countries to force contraceptives and abortion rights. And also like in Europe, the countries definitely do favor abortion. Like in Europe, England is definitely pressuring citizens more and more to be in favor of pro-choice.
The European Union is as a whole, don't you think? Yeah. We'll leave that aside for the moment. Talk about freedom of speech briefly. Why is that important?
Freedom of speech is important because it gives us the right to basically talk about all these issues. It's like kind of like the all-encompassing issue. Like, we wouldn't be able to talk about like pro-life or wanting small government or capitalism if we didn't have the right to speak about it. And that's why it's like the number one on the Constitution, because if you don't have the right to protest your government or protest the establishment, then you just like you're done for. Like, you can't like go forward with movements.
I think you're right on that. Thank you very much, Thomas. Thank you. Well done. All right, I'll try to get this board in before I wrap up. Is this Ethan's board? Ethan, you need to bring out one or two points that have been brought out already. That's a challenge, right?
All right. I'm Ethan Schultz. I'm from Dallas, Texas.
You want to hold that against you?
Yeah. Something that hasn't been brought up yet, and that's not actually even on the board, is something that I believe in personally. Liberals are just getting dumber. Let's just face the fact. And one of the problems with our generation is that currently we're having to defend the obvious. We have to defend gender. We have to prove points that in the past, past generations were just given. And trying to convince others who cannot be convinced, if you are steadfast to your argument, but you don't know anything about it, you're not going to change, right? So that's something I believe in. And another thing is something that Bay brought up yesterday, and I want to elaborate on, is trade with protectionism versus globalism. One thing that liberals want on trade is globalize, 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 right? Third world countries get up. But we have to remember, there are some people we don't want to globalize, right? And as long as there are Americans suffering on healthcare and everything else, we need to focus on ourselves first and build up.
Anything else?
You want me to explain that?
Yeah, identify
as a frying pan. I don't identify as a frying pan, personally. I'm on my debate team. It's very liberal. Mm-hmm. Somehow in October, I got to vice president. And I had to fill out a form for a little web page. And the gender box was fill in your own. So I thought I'd give them a taste of their own medicine. And I put, I identify as a frying pan. Mm-hmm. So my debate teacher is not happy.
All right, we'll have to call you the frying pan from here on out. You may know this, but Grant Strobel, who's the chairman of Young Americans for Freedom, is a junior at Michigan, the University of Michigan, but they were given the option of listing the pronoun that they preferred, And he filled in that he wanted to be addressed as His Majesty. And that has given him a lot of ribbing since then, but it pretty much gummed up the works at the University of Michigan. All right. The group that was here before that was asked to be the critics, what's the biggest criticism of modern-day conservatism? Someone from that group. Yes.
So I'd say, like, the biggest criticism from liberals?
Yes. What's the toughest issue to, as a conservative, advancing conservative ideas among high school students, so what's the toughest liberal argument?
I guess it kind of pertains to all the issues, but liberals say that conservatives don't care, that we don't care about people, that we just want to push our agenda, and that we don't care who gets trampled, you know, under. Like, that's liberalism's great argument against conservatism, that we just don't care. And then, conversely, liberals say that they do care and that they're championing, you know, the small man, and they're, you know, up for everyone, but yeah.
It's a good point. Let me address that point and then give you one more equality argument to use in your classroom. Conservatives do put stress on the best social program is doing well in your own life, raising your family, taking care of yourself as best you can, and then broadening it out. As a person of faith, I believe I have an obligation to help those of the less fortunate. Absolutely, I have that obligation. I think most conservatives believe that. But I do not fulfill that obligation by reaching into your pocketbook and saying, your family was successful, give me your money. That doesn't fulfill my obligation. When I look at the religious teachers that I put the greatest stock in, I would begin with Jesus, of course. And at no point did he ever say, let's give more power to government and then let government handle these problems. He called people for to do it individually. Leftists try to equate raising taxes, reaching in other people's pocketbooks with being generous. That's not being generous with their money. That's being generous with someone else's money. It's actually, and they try to portray conservatives as greedy. You saw Newt Gingrich portrayed as Uncle Scrooge, maybe the ultimate Uncle Scrooge in the sense that the story ends up, perhaps, but not a fair representation of conservative ideas. Conservatism contrasts with what the liberals' point of view is, with almost all of liberalism is built on envy and coveting thy neighbor's goods. So when the left criticizes you being greedy because you try to keep money that you earned yourself and spend it yourself, including spending it on charities, the flip side of that is that they are envious. They are coveting their neighbor's goods. And that's the core concept behind socialism. It's the core concept that drove the Nazis to attack Jewish families because they had more. It was the core concept that drove the Soviet Union to attack the kulaks because they had more. The despicable people in the 20th century all attacked other people for having more and stoked the envy and stoked the coveting of their neighbor's goods, and it led to horrific results. The left today is doing exactly the same thing. They're trying to stoke envy and coveting to drive your generation to attack anyone who is more successful than they are. And you should be on guard for that. The final example I want to give you that you could use, some of you may have already heard about it. It's a very popular conservative concept, but you can certainly use it with your teachers. It's the grading system. Your teachers, you could go to them and say, these few kids in our class getting A's, A pluses, they've listened very carefully, they've absorbed it all. Some of the backbenchers are getting F's. These people don't need it to get into a good school. Let's eliminate the idea of giving an A+, and let's lift the people getting an F to a D. And then you could carry that a little bit further. We really don't need A's. Let's just have B's and no longer have D's. Let's have B's and C's. You know what would happen. Your teacher knows what would happen. The nights you cram for an exam to do a little bit better, you would no longer do because you're going to get a C or a B anyway. pretty soon the whole academic work of the whole class will sag. Your teachers know that, and that's why they have a different system based upon the outcome, based upon the results. And so remember that concept because it rebuts so many core liberal concepts, and it's easy to understand as a high school student, as a college student, as an American citizen. Jolie was very generous to give me a lot of time this morning. I appreciated all your input. I wish I could have even more, but these discussions we hope will continue in your dorm rooms and in the hotels and for the rest of the weekend. Thank you very much, Jolie.
Thank you. All right, guys, we're going to take about a 5-minute break, so feel free to use the restrooms, grab some coffee, and we'll be back in your seats in 5 minutes.